this one's messed up. You want to use the smaller one here? Use this one. Because this one, look, it's just dangling. I've got to get a new wick on it. And I should have thought of that already.
Fire on that thing. The fire would just be dangling.
Yeah, it might drip.
Like everything on fire.
Yeah, which sounds cool, but it's not really cool.
And all we would hear is whoosh, and it would all be gone.
Yeah, a 160-year-old building would go up in smoke.
160-year-old.
This building is 160 this year. It's almost as old as me. All right, kiddo.
Good morning.
According to Cindy, the prelude did not help people stop talking, and that's how our church rolls, and that's okay. She played it as loud as she could, so it's just the way it is. So, good morning, everyone. Good morning. Here we are. We're at our worship today. Let's stand up and go into Scripture today. We'll go into Galatians chapter 6. We've been talking about Galatians for a month and a half, the final week of it, as I teach from it today on a Sunday, and then Wednesday night we will discuss the entire chapter of 6. Now, the only bad part about being the leader today, reading aloud, is you have to actually breathe and open your mouth and nose from the skunk smell. Yes, we do have a skunk that's climbed underneath the building. We haven't found him yet. He'll probably prance down the aisle to join the church at the end. But anyway, so who'd like to be the leader today? Anybody just in the mood? Like, I'm going to read from that this morning. I am. Paula, thank you. Take us down this, please.
Do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked.
A man reaps what he sows. Whoever sows to please their flesh,
from the flesh will reap destruction.
Yeah. Whoever sows to please the Spirit, from the Spirit will reap eternal life. It's a big difference. Life or death, we treat it as trivial, but it is not. Let's pray. Lord, let us follow the Spirit, not the flesh. We do not need to follow the flesh. We live in a world that not only lives by the flesh, they glorify it, they worship it, they throw it in our faces, and more than that, they throw it in our children's faces. Lord, let us live by the Spirit, live by you, live by the instruction of the Bible, the leading of the Holy Spirit. Let us now affirm our faith by reciting together as a church family the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let's stay standing together. We'll go into our first hymn. And today we have When We All Get to Heaven. I think there might be three. Let me look on the book here. 483. Four verses. Not 17. Thank you, Lord.
Us a place.
sing and shout for victory. While we walk the pilgrim pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sign. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we
They'll be back next week, and during the service, Carrie had a nice idea that we will have a small, short prayer vigil time for the family as they continue to deal with this. And Heather and Chris participate with that with all of us. We have our love offering basket available. It's in the back on the table where the offering is and the communion. And it's marked with a picture of Serenity with full unicorn headband. And if you would like to give towards her funeral expenses, that basket will be back there today. And then since that's very last moment, next week we will pass that basket around if anybody wants to give towards that. And I know some of you already have. I noticed it when I walked by. But we'll find out during this week where we need to send those funds to, whether it is straight to the funeral home when all that's established. They've not even released the body yet. So it's, they know not much more than I'm telling you right now. Be in prayer for that family. They have been rocked. Another one I'll mention that's on our prayer list, Bruce Owens. Any of you all Henry County school system folks or sports fans know Mr. Owens was a big part of sports and teaching in Henry County for several decades. He's been in the nursing home for a while. I lost his son Jeff a couple years ago, and now Bruce has passed away this week. So he's on our prayer list for prayer, but he's gone on. So prayers for Bruce Owens' family. And now I open it up to all of you. Any prayer needs or praises? Miss Linda.
In Galatians, it says that we are to bear one another's burdens. And we found out this week that our neighbor, directly next to us, Diana Baxter, has donated her kidney to a friend in Texas. She'll be leaving this week to fly down.
Praise for her to do that selfless act, and prayers for the procedure, not only for Diana, that it goes well for her, but for the recipient too. Kidney transplants are serious business. Prayers for Diana Baxter. Who else today? Donna.
You could take Bertie Adams off the list.
Mm-hmm.
He passed away.
Oh, dear. Updating us on that. And always, folks, if you see something that's on there that should not be any longer, some of you sometimes give me an extra bulletin with things circled or marked out. All good. Troy?
You can take Miss Moore, Betsy Moore, off. She's back at work.
Back at work.
84 and still there. Yep.
Very good. From 84 and back at work.
Yep.
Best thing.
Yep.
Get back at work. Miss Kat.
Lori Kohler.
In Southern Indiana, and she and Gary have been in our church before with our shootout times that we've done over the years in the past. So. injustice. It is an evil that's overtaken. Mostly our youth. Not just youth. Mostly. Any others today? Harriet? Yeah, and pray for that. You know, Leland has lots of health concerns, although they've been doing a little bit better to the point where he thought he was going to be able to drive himself to church today. We offered to go get him in our caravan, but he said, no, I won't drive. So here's an obstacle put in the way. You try to do something, get better, do better, feel better. The devil's going to tempt you with the illness. So let's get him into worship and let him continue to recover. Bart. Sorry to hear that. Yes, ma'am. A good doctor's report. It's good to have a praise. We've got plenty of prayer requests today, but positive direction, we'll take it. So, good doctor report for Samantha. Adrian. If she would clue me in, or she kept looking distantly away from me. I think the skunk had affected her thought process. But yeah, she was bringing it up. Santa did have a scare, but doing hopefully okay. Going through that, it's all encompassing. It's all good. A lot of y'all have been down that same road before, either yourself or with your kids. Any others today? Tricia. I know a lot of you probably have some unspoken prayer needs. That's why we put it on there. I was noticing looking at another of our local churches, they put their prayer list online every week. And at the very bottom, it said unspoken prayer. Troy, you have another one?
Yes, I just thought of this. A buddy of mine does some excavation work for me. Aaron Lyons, pretty good family out here in Bethlehem. 17-year-old son is in the hospital with COVID. He's been in there 6 weeks on a ventilator. He's come really close to death. He's special needs in that. He's got, his lungs are like half the size of normal lungs. So that's really got him. Yeah, so doing better, but still. Can't remember, I think his name's Troy. I'm not sure his name, but Aaron Lyons is the dad. So.
Lungs are what it hits. And he's got lung issues.
Yes.
Continue to pray for that. I know that there's a lot of families still affected by that. I know the numbers in Kentucky and worldwide are going down precipitously, and so glad of that, but it's not over yet. And it'll be a thing we adapt to. Still need. And folks like Aaron's son are the ones that's going to continue to pick off for illness. Do we have any others today? All right, let's pause and take some quiet time. The way that you pray privately. And I'll close us. Lord, we do pray today for all the needs we've had brought up. We thank you and praise you for good doctor's appointments from two of our young ladies, Samantha and Mary. Pray that they things go well there. Pray for Lori Coleman, dealing with a lot right now medically, and Jan Brody, looking at an upcoming surgery. For Diana Baxter and her selfless gift of a kidney, that surgery goes well for both parties. For Aaron Lyons' young son in the hospital on ventilator. He already has enough issues. For Leland Payton, trying his best to get to worship today. The families of David Peterson and Vernon Adams that we've noted today are on the prayer list and they've passed away. The family of Bruce Owens, a big figure at Henry County School in sports history for the last several decades. For unspoken prayer needs. For continued prayer for our elder and one of our patriarchs, the family of Charles Adams. We won't even know how that feels to be without him yet. And for all the extended family of little Serenity McKinney, it's going to be in the news a whole lot more this week. And she's family of church family, so this is right at home. Lord, help that family know what to do, know how to cope, and help them to seek your face. That should be where we go. But if folks have not been with you solid and strong, they may not know that. Help them, help Chris and Heather as they minister right now to that family. Help them know. It's in the name of Jesus we do pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. We're going to our announcements. We're going to our celebrations time. This is the last full week of February that I have on the calendar here. The one birthday that I know that we have this week is Earl Jr. I do not see him. If he's here, he might be hiding behind Daryl and Pam. He don't want to be sung to, but if he's not here, we'll sing to him when he comes back, hopefully next week. And I know there's an anniversary in the house this week. Am I right? Oh, she looked at me, so it must be true. So I can't ask Mike because he might be at his own church. But Wanda, how many years have been?
21.
And they were married right here, weren't you? So 21 years ago, this coming Thursday, the 24th, am I right? So we're going to sing happy anniversary to Wanda and Mike. Let's have it.
Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary, Wanda and Mike. Happy anniversary to you.
Many, many more. What'd you say, Karen Darwin?
Just saying.
Just saying? Man. Goodness, you ought to join the choir with that way you pulled out like that. It's pretty good. I really enjoyed that a lot. All right, some announcements. One thing is that I did put in here, and I, of course, made messes of it. Glad Harriet folded the bulletin and found it. I do have your new church board there. So I know that Troy, as our new board chair, is going to be canvassing board members today to see when we can have that first meeting of the new church year, which look for it to happen very soon in the beginning of March. So if you're a board member, brand spanking new, or not, or if you're an elder, please be sure you talk to Troy, one of the men with a long beard in this church. So see him, and we'll get it scheduled. I'll put it in the bulletin the moment that it is planned.
We're going to plan it for the second Sunday in March. Just so everybody hears, if there's a conflict there, let me know. After church.
So that should be March 13th?
March 13th.
All right. I'll mark it in mine. We'll put it in the bulletin for next Sunday, March 13th, board meeting. Good deal. All right, so you have that list there. This week, we do play volleyball again. Coach Rachel, how did we do last week? We played Cropper. They're good.
We won,
that's right. And it was cool because we've been having a cobble together lineups the whole season, back and forth. And Marvin Casey came just to, in a innocently watch a game, and Barb never even got to sit down hardly. We're like, get in the game so we can have enough girls to play with enough guys, and they beat the defending champions. So, big time. Yeah. Best we played is, yeah, we can clap for that. Right. Good job, kids. So, this week we play Elmberg, who has been off to a really good start this season. They've done very well. So, 7 o'clock is our game. Come watch. It's a really good time at Crawford. Tuesday night, 7 o'clock, Elmberg is our opponent. Wednesday night this week, our final meeting of the book of Galatians, chapter 6. Read ahead, take your notes. It has been a really good discussion to the point that I had to be the bad cop Wednesday night and say, all right, we got to wrap it up before midnight, before we turn into a pumpkin. So it was good. Next Sunday, we'll have our Sunday school classes. Remember that we have a new class for mature ladies. Immature ladies are welcome too, but come on, be fine. We're slowly building a class group so we can try to reach as many folks in this congregation as possible. The Wednesday after that, you might see we're going to have a movie night. It is going to be Ash Wednesday on March 2nd. We will have ashes if you like to have those administered and for prayer. And we'll watch the 4th God's Not Dead movie in the fellowship hall. We started a new choir practice today. And if you weren't able to be there, I know we were missing some today. Come 2 weeks from today, we'll get back into that. And then finally, last thing I'll mention from my end of things is that we'll be starting a Bible study the week of March 9th, and I will have a sign-up sheet for if you want a book. I'll have that paper next week. I might even have it Wednesday night. I couldn't pull it off today with lots of things going on, but hopefully we'll get that, and you'll see it's in there. Gary, anything about the tea? I know you do. Save the date, it's March 19th.
Yes.
Put it on your calendar. Let's show out. Have everybody there. All right. Let's move into our next part of our service. What I had listed as a modern hymn. It's not a new song. And Merle Haggard is no longer with us on this world, but it is a new telling. And I've listened to this several times the last couple days because it's a beautiful rendition of this song. So if you at all like country music and you like Hag, well, let's sing it together anyway. Stand up, let's sing What a Friend We Have in Jesus. It is a fantastic verse.
Because we do not One for the road. Trust him in gathered around the table, Jesus took the bread, he blessed it, and he broke it. He said, "This represents my body that will be broken for you. Take and eat." In the same way, he blessed the wine to give it to his disciples. He said, "This represents the blood that will be shed for salvation. Do this to remember me." As we do every day, for all time, let us thank you for all that you have done, all that you're doing, and all that you will do. Thank you for everything.
I told you all, we have a love offering basket back there for a little serenity, but our regular offering plate is right back there in the back on the same table. And those of our online congregation can still send that to our post office box. P.O. Box 495, Newcastle, Kentucky 40050. Let's stand for the doxology. Praise God
from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Lord, put it in our hearts to follow you. Part of that is taking this Holy Communion that we can remember you and think of your body and blood broken and shed for us. Part of it is with an offering that we do in order to continue your work as seen fit by the body of Christ to people who believe in you as Lord and Savior. And now we open up your holy book, the only one we need for instruction, for discipline, for love from you. Now let us go into there and learn more about you. In the name of Jesus, we do pray. Amen. Amen. May be seated. The strange and maybe scary picture on the front of your bulletin on the screen today is a fragment from 1700 years ago from the book of Galatians. Now, that's not the original text, because the original letter would have been about almost 2,000 years old, but it's pretty gosh darn old. Book of Galatians, maybe Paul's first letter, as we've seen, and more archaeology leading that way. But we'll talk about that more in a minute. I've put into mind right now about the seriousness of our task here, and I was thinking just a while ago about the conversation I had yet again with a student at school. I have 662 of my closest friends that I'll be winding up my journey with them here in about 3.5 months. But there's a third grade girl right now who is really on fire for the Lord at our school. And a couple of things I've shared with you before. One of them is that she's a religious viewer of The Chosen. So we talk about the show that she watches with her grandmother. And I wonder how many of you learned about the Bible from your grandmother. I bet a lot of you. She's usually a matriarch of the faith in our family. So the little girl really perked my ears when she started telling me about The Chosen. Later in the school year, after we restarted FCA and started having it just really normal like we had it before, the gym and the playground, one time we were outside and we had a little over 100 kids outside playing, and she said, "Wait, what, all of these kids are in FCA?" I said, "Yeah, there's right now there's 122, I think." And she said, "So this many people love Jesus?" Wow. Yeah, I hope so. Well, just Friday at school, I missed school Thursday, but went back Friday after Charles's services, and she said, she was in my class, she said, "So, how was it?" And I said, "Well, it was very sad, and it rained." You know, and one of you commented online Thursday morning, "Oh, what a dreary weather for what a sad day," and it was. Very sad. Charles's day was pouring down rain, and just the way it was, it felt. That was the mood. Missing someone so badly. But she said, "Well, That's what you do, isn't it? You go to the church. And I said, yeah, and soon I'll be able to do that more after I retire. And she said, well, that'll be easy, right? Because as the preacher, all you got to do is go up there and talk a few minutes one day a week, right? I said, yeah, that's right. That's it. You got it. It's so easy. And I said, no, actually, the job at the church is much harder than the job at the school. Because the job at the school, I've been doing so long, 27 years, that a lot of it, I hate to say it, but it's true, when you've been in a job that long, some of it becomes autopilot. Some of it, you know, whether you're in business or a plant or a school or a farm or wherever you are, some things just become easy to handle habit. It's not just that at school. And I didn't mean to say that the church gig is all toil and drudgery. It's not. We love what we do. It's hard. It's really hard. Because as we've had in the last couple of years, more people, that equals more hurting people. More people who need a loving Savior and people that love that Savior together. So, you all know we're on the phone with a lot of you, a whole bunch, and seeing you a whole bunch and doing things a lot, and we love it. Well, this book of Galatians has been, in my heart, as timely as it can be with all of that, because it talks in this section that I'm going to read to you now about being totally fed up with the world. Are any of you fed up with the world right now? If you nod your head that hard, it's going to hurt, so be careful, okay? Some of you are, yes, I really am, and let me tell... No, we'll just be nice, okay? I'm tired of it too, but this is nothing new. You've read the Bible. There's nothing new under the sun. It's true. Everything that we're going through right now, maybe not the specific ways, but it's happened. Been there, done that. Got the book, and the book is the Bible. I'm going to read about that now because the theme that I've seen throughout these chapters leading up to the finale in chapter 6 is that Paul is really trying to help these people understand the difference between living under the law and living in the Spirit. There in the early church of Galatia, we're talking just a decade or two past Christ's ascension to heaven, they're already falling back into the old ways. They've got the free gift. Lots of them have even seen Jesus. But they're falling back into the old ways. Didn't take long. It says in verse 11 and following, I'm going to read some of the very last verses of the chapter, some of the very last verses of the book of Galatians at all, the whole letter. It says here, see what large letters I use as I write to you with my own hand. Now, some people say, well, that's probably because Paul was hard of sight. He had a seeing problem. A lot of people think that was maybe the thorn in his flesh. I think it was something deeper than that. But a lot of folks think that he was struck blind and his eyesight the rest of his life became something that he struggled with. So he probably wrote really big, like some of us have a large print Bible. I think, on the other hand, what he's doing here is that he's taken the parchment or the papyrus or whatever it's on from his scribe said, get out of the way. I'm taking over. I'm going to write the rest of this letter. Because he's been giving dictation, probably, to a young man who has been writing this down. And now at the end, he's like, all right, I've got to take over. This is the same guy who said, I wish I could use a different tone of voice with you because I'm so perplexed with you at the end of one of the other chapters. He wants this voice to get across. So he's saying, see what large letters I write. He's basically saying, live by the Spirit. You idiots. He left the idiots part out. Maybe erased it. Maybe it was trimmed off the bottom or whatever. But here's what he said. He said, those who want to impress people by means of the flesh are trying to compel you to be circumcised. Now that was the big thing. If you're a Jew back then, you'd better be circumcised. Now there's medical and good physical reasons for that to happen as far as health and safety. And we still use that procedure a lot today. But back then, that was meant to show, I am a Jew. Period. Thou shalt be circumcised. Now, unless I was mistaken, Jesus came and said, you know what? I'm the new way. I'm not here to abolish the law. I'm here to fulfill it. But this is a new way. You do not have to be slaves to the law, such as with circumcision. But people came in and said, well, yeah, we still need to be circumcised. Because, moving on, it says, the only reason they do this is to avoid being persecuted for the cross of Christ. These jokers, the Judaizers, they want to avoid persecution. They want to avoid carrying the cross. They want to look good in society. They want to not stand out as someone of the new way. They want to hold on to the old way. They're not bold and brave and faithful enough to go out on that limb and say, you know, I'm going to live for Jesus. He says do this, let's do this. Instead, they're saying, no, that's nice. Praise God. But we're still going to hold on to the old ways too. Just saying. It gets worse. Now, what's right here is bad enough. They want to avoid persecution. It gets worse. Not even those who are circumcised keep the law. Yet they want you to be circumcised, that they may boast about your circumcision in the flesh. Now, one of the catchphrases the last couple of years, as the world has been flipped upside down and people have decided to use political gain in a huge worldwide crisis to get their own way, is to do such things that are labeled rules for thee, not for me. A lot of politicians and celebrities right now are under fire because they are supporting continuing their mandates, their illegal mandates, so much in their states. But they're not following themselves. Wouldn't be caught dead following. A lot of people had a problem last week with the Super Bowl happening in Southern California. Now you might look at it one way of, hey, didn't see a mask there. People were ready to move out of the country. Great. You be you. On the other hand, the kids that went to school the next morning on Monday, every one of them had to wear a mask. Which is it? I'll tell you what it is. It's rules for thee, not for me. Paul's writing here, those folks that are preaching circumcision, they're not following the law either. They just want to make sure you do. Now, the folks that are wanting to follow Jesus in the new way, first couple of decades after Jesus rose from the dead and ascended to heaven, they're saying, you know what? The focus on the law does not have to be anymore. One thing we've talked about on Wednesday nights is that the original covenant was not with Moses. The original covenant was with Abraham. This is a promise of a Savior. It wasn't a promise of the Ten Commandments coming down to be the way we live forever. It's a promise of the seed of Abraham, Jesus, to be our Savior, to make the need for the law to go away. So when Jesus did come to this earth to fulfill all of that prophecy, the need for following all those hundreds of rules and regulations went away. But was that enough? Of course not. Now, I used an example from the Super Bowl and of politicians and of celebrities using the pandemic for the last 2 years for political gain. It doesn't have to be that. There's other ways we do it as church people. So many of us know loved ones who say, yeah, sure, I'd like to come to church, sure, but they're going to look down their nose at me. They're going to try to tell me how to live my life when they're not doing it themselves. They're going to be a Saturday center Sunday saint, and I don't want it. They're going to be, and here's the H word, hypocrite. And that's a description of it right there, a biblical description, and we do it. So Paul, in response, says, may I never boast except back then? You know, it said earlier in Galatians, if you boast about that, you focus on that, you've got to keep the entire letter of the law. If your thing is the law, if that's your focus, if you say your salvation is with circumcision, then, buddy, you got to follow all 611 million laws. Because you focus on one, you focus on all. That's kind of like when we say a sin is a sin is a sin. Same thing. If you sin, then you are a sinner. It's not because your sin is bigger and louder and more flamboyant than anyone else's. You're a sinner. I'm a sinner. We follow that law, we're going to fail, we're going to fall on our face. It's not God's plan. It's not God's plan for folks to come into a church building, whether it's Drennon or otherwise, and feel terrible about themselves. It should be a place you come in and you are welcomed, and you're made to feel like, oh, they get me. I'm a hot mess. And so are they. So we can be a hot mess together and point towards a Savior who knows it and loves us anyway and offers us a free salvation. He went on that wooden cross, took it away. So Paul, he says, may I never boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. And you know, this is a boastful man. He's been there, done that. He's got a t-shirt that says, let's boast. Not anymore. Goes on, he says, through which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. So that cross, he looks at the crucifixion, not only of his Savior sitting on that tree, but he says that whole world is crucified with that cross, because the world is as nothing. It is as filthy rags to me, the world. And by the way, the world, I'm crucified to it as well. I have nothing left for the world, but the world has nothing left for me. I'm simply following Jesus Christ. Neither circumcision nor uncircumcision means anything. Whether you want pink carpet or green carpet in the church means nothing. Those are the circumcision issues we deal with. 21st century. Whether you want contemporary Christian music or praise music or hymnal music means nothing to me, would say Jesus. Same as saying circumcision versus uncircumcision. Living by the law. It says, what counts as a new creation? Are you that? A new creation. Peace and mercy to all who follow this rule, to the Israel of God. And when he's saying the Israel of God, what he's talking about there is the Israel that God intends for his people. Not the Israel of the rules, the regulations, and sticking with Judaizing that they were doing with this new creation of Christianity. It was the Israel that God intended. His people, his place, his covenant. And we're looking at it. We have at our fingertips life in Christ, but we turn it down. Instead of crucifying the world on that cross and crucifying ourselves in the face of the world on that cross, instead we pick it right back up and say, no, I'm going to peel it off of that cross. I'm going to take it with me. I'm going to keep it. It's my own. I do it. I get so stressed. Oh, I hate it. And one of the worst times is usually Saturday night and Sunday morning, because church prep's going on, final moment, even if I've got everything done and ready and packed and sealed with a bow on it, there's going to be something. I bet you have that too. You might come in that door on Sunday morning sometimes, you and your spouse or your kid, you got a big smile on your face, and you sure don't feel it. I feel like screaming, Brother Corey. I feel like crying. I feel like turning around, getting in that car, and going back home. But I got to put my good face on because I'm at church. more and just howled and screamed and went on our knees, it might be a more fruitful service, to be honest, and get it all out. You know, maybe that'll be the way we do it from now on. I don't know. Forget the hens will just come in and howl. Sound like a Bigfoot sighting in Drennon Springs. Cool, we'll be on TV. Peace and mercy to all who follow this rule, to the Israel of God. Yeah, this one rule. Not the hundreds of laws and rules. The one rule of a new creation. Loving God and loving your neighbor. No circumcision. No expectations for dress code in the church. No boasting except in Christ. It's that old. But it's brand new. It's old, but it's new. It's complex, but it's simple. There's no strings attached. We need desperately to take what we know is true out of this building and share it with other people. Feel frustrated with your Christian life, with your church life, and think, you know, just going on a Sunday or a Wednesday or doing whatever. I just feel like, yeah, we're serving the church, we're doing well, but I want to be more like Jesus. I want to live more for Him and less for the world. Well, let's do it. Let's do it. You know, we've had a couple of good years of growth to where a day like today with 52. Well, that's four less than we had last year. What that says to me, we've grown and grown and grown, and we kind of plateau a little bit. You know why we do? Because we don't go yank other people out of where they are in their lives and say, come on in to Jesus. Let's get them. We've got room in these pews. One of the number that would have been up there last, middle of February, that 56, one of them, he's in heaven now. His number can't be put back here in the same way. But if we take the legacy of a man like Charles Adams and say, you know what? The kindness, the sweetness, the openness, the acceptance of a man like that who didn't care where you were from or what you did or what you were about, he just smiled and said, would you like a sucker? Welcome. Can we be like that? Not just here either. Don't just put on your happy face because you walked in. You're afraid somebody's going to see that you've been hollering and screaming in the car or feel like howling into a pillow. It's okay. Go ahead, do it. I'll join you. Let's take it out there. We're going to sing our hymn of invitation now. I chose it because we do need to revive ourselves. You know, we might think, hey, we're doing better than we were a few years ago. We're doing better than we were 10 years ago. We're on an uptick. Well, that uptick don't have to last. We need a revival in our hearts. We need to grow. And not grow so that the pocketbook can look better. Grow so that we know that more people we love are going to be with Jesus when their name is called. We don't know when that name's going to be called. We're praying about a little girl who's 4 and a half whose name was called. She gets a free ticket. She's not to the age of accountability. We know where she is. But none of us have an eternal ticket that said, you're going to stay on earth forever. We need to be ready. Let's sing together. If you have anything you want to pray about, or join the church, or say, let's get baptized when we break the ice of the creek, come up during the song. Talk to me. We'll sing together. Revive us again. Let's stand and sing.
Hallelujah. for us today, please?
Heavenly Father, guide us this week and bless us to do and say and be what we say we are, the followers of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Let us show it and be the real people that we should be, not something that is hid under mask. But guide us and help us to help others and show them that this is the right way to follow and believe in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen. Chuck?
Yes, sir.
How you doing, buddy?
Good.